To the Holy Spirit. Pray with me. Oh God, the Holy Spirit, come to us and among us. Come as the wind and cleanse us. Come as the fire and burn. Come as the dew and refresh. Convict, convert, and consecrate many hearts and lives to our great good and to thy greater glory. And this we ask for Jesus Christ's sake. Amen. Our first song is Hosanna, Loud Hosanna. And if you want to, adults, you can process with the children. Just join in the parade.
All right, please stand.
Singing this morning, so we're anxious to hear them. Announcements that we need to make this morning, we've got a board meeting on Tuesday. We've got our Wednesday Lenten lunches. This Wednesday is going to be at Brookshire First United Methodist Church with Patterson United Methodist Church hosting. So they're still working on their fellowship hall over at Patterson, so Brookshire was nice enough to allow them to host there. So that's this Wednesday at noon. And then on Friday, we have Good Friday service here at 7:30 in the evening. It'll be a service of darkness. And I hope you'll come and we'll remember the Lord's crucifixion. And then, of course, next Sunday, Easter. We have Easter sunrise out of San Philip. We skipped a couple of years due to COVID, but we're back out at San Philip at 7 a.m. on Easter Sunday morning, and then here in our sanctuary at 10. So come and celebrate with us on Easter. Kay, you want to say a word about the Sunday after Easter?
Yes, the Sunday after Easter. We have, during the 10 o'clock service, and there is only one service that day at 10, the choir, the band, the children, the handbells, it will be another Easter celebration the Sunday after Easter. Yes.
That will be the 24th. So right here, big musical Sunday on the 24th. All right, joys. What joys would you like to share this morning, Ron?
I want to thank everybody for the sympathy card they've sent for my sister's passing. Thank you.
I've got my mom and dad and my middle son and his wife here, so right there. They're not on the front row, but they are in the front row apparently. Somebody sitting and the youngest son and his significant other are supposed to come trailing in here sometime or another. So if you see them, you know, poke at them and say, "You're late." Other joys. Who else has a joy? Right here. Say it real loud. You're getting your tonsils out tomorrow. Are you sure that's not fair? Because
he gets to eat ice cream.
Oh, it's the ice cream. Oh, okay. How many days do you get to eat ice cream? 2 weeks?
Doctor's orders.
Yeah, if the doctor said so, that's it. No wonder he's calling it a joy.
I passed my SACER test. I'm a team leader now at one of our.
All right. So what shift do you work where you can come by and say hello?
I work mornings on Monday, Tuesdays, or morning through like the midday on Monday, Tuesday, Thursdays, and
I can remember Mondays and Tuesdays. So
Monday, Tuesday, Thursday, I work morning. Friday and Saturday, I work 3 to 11.
So he's a, what did you say? Shift?
Team leader.
Team leader at Waterbury.
Soon to be manager.
Well, right here to see him.
I already saw him.
You saw him? Huh? Kathy, you have a joy?
I'm looking forward to next Sunday seeing the cut flowers on the cross. And if everybody can help out by bringing some cut flowers.
We're going to have our flowering cross out front next Sunday. So if you've got fresh flowers at home and have something blooming, bring those and we'll decorate the cross. Wonderful. Okay, yes, ma'am.
Our joy is our four of my grandchildren are here and my daughter. And
all right. We're glad y'all are here.
And we're glad.
All right. Other joys. James?
We're very thankful for everybody's prayers for Charlotte Burnham is home and doing better than everybody expected her to. So thank everybody for the prayers.
Good. We were afraid that she might not even make it through surgery, but she seemed to fly through that, didn't she? That's great. All right, I saw somebody else. Bonnie?
Yes, I'd like to say that the American Legion Auxiliary Ladies, we donated $1,000 to the Easter extravaganza.
That's a joy. That's wonderful. The Ladies Auxiliary for the
Easter thing. The American Legion.
The American Legion. Okay. Wonderful. Yeah, this is going to be the first full-blown extravaganza since I've been here. Last year we had kind of a limited one, and they've been telling me something. Brother Mike, you haven't seen anything yet. Okay, we'll see. All right. Other joys, anybody else this morning?
I'll have to hear about Mickey's waiting on his truck, his new truck.
Mickey's got a new truck?
But I don't have to hear about it anymore.
Yeah, that's the important part. You don't have to hear me
talk
about it anymore.
All right, let's keep singing. We're going to sing Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone. Let's stand and sing together.
Oh,
you guys, Billy. Now, come on up here. Watch those microphones. Oh, sit down. Story time. So, it's Palm Sunday. So, do y'all know the story? Jesus got on a donkey and rode into Jerusalem, and people put down palms and they laid down their cloaks and some other branches. Yeah, everybody come on up. I forgot we got more out there. We got a big bunch today. Come on, girls. Come on up. So we're talking about Palm Sunday. So the symbolism, though, is what was important. Because he rode a donkey. Now, this goes back to the ancient kings of Israel. And when they would go out to battle, and they would come back home to Jerusalem, of course, now if they lost the battle, they didn't have a parade, right? You don't have a parade after losing a battle, right? Not usually. So when they would have a victory, the king... What kind of animals do kings normally ride?
Horses.
And what color horse?
White.
You got a big white horse, right? You want the biggest and the whitest horse you can find so everybody will know he's the king, right? And he led the army in victory. But in Israel... they had a tradition that the king would come back home and he would ride a donkey. And a little donkey, too. Now, let's think. Why would the king of Israel ride a donkey after a great victory? What is he trying to say? What do you think? What he was saying was, as the king, he was trying to say to the people, I didn't do this. I didn't win the victory. Who won the victory? God. Our God won the victory. And I'm just his servant, and so I ride a donkey. I don't ride a big white horse, because it's not about me, it's about God. And that's what Jesus was doing. He was saying, everything that's about to happen here in Jerusalem this week is all about God. And I want y'all, when you look at me, Jesus was saying, when you look at me, Jesus, I want you to think of God. And so that's what he was doing. That's pretty neat, isn't it? Yeah. Let's say a prayer. Thank you, Lord, for riding into our lives on the donkey to be with us and to help us every day. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Thank y'all for coming up. Hey, why don't you stay right here? I'm not going anywhere. I've got your papers. All right.
Ready? All right. Thank you.
He sent two of his disciples on ahead. He told them, go into the next village where you will find a young donkey that has never been ridden. Untie the donkey and bring it here. If anyone asks why you are doing that, just say, the Lord needs it. They went off and found everything just as Jesus had said. While they were untying the donkey, its owners asked, why are you doing that? They answered, the Lord needs it. Then they led the donkey to Jesus. They put some of their clothes on its back and helped Jesus get on. And as he rode along, the people spread clothes on the road in front of him. When Jesus was starting down the Mount of Olives, his large crowd of disciples were happy and praised God because of all the miracles they had seen. They shouted, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory to God. Some Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, teacher, make your disciples stop shouting. But Jesus answered, if they keep quiet, these stones will start shouting. When Jesus came closer and could see Jerusalem, he cried and said, it is too bad that today your people don't know what will bring them peace. Now it is hidden from them. Jerusalem, the time will come when your enemies will build walls around you to attack you. Armies will surround you and close in on you from every side. They will level you to the ground and kill your people. Not one stone in your buildings will be left on top of another. This will happen because you did not see that God had come to save you. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Amen. Will you bow with me for a word of prayer? May the words of my mouth, the meditations of our hearts, be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our redeemer. Amen. I want to give a note on the text here. Some people are really taken by the fact that Jesus seems to know what's going to happen. You can go into the next village and there'll be a donkey tied up there. How did he know that? Some people think of it as a miracle. I begin to see it for what I really think it is it's a sign of how often he had been there. In the day, in Jesus' day, a Jewish male who lived within distance of Jerusalem was to come to Jerusalem at least 3 times a year for the festivals. So, if Jesus had been coming since he turned 12, and we have that story of him coming with his parents when he was 12, remember that story?
Yes.
Yeah. And it had been 20 years or more, so he had been to Jerusalem at least 60 times. This was a sign that Jesus was a good Jew. He came to the festivals that he was supposed to every year. And this is how he knew where things were. If I had been to Jerusalem 60 times in my lifetime, would you think I knew a thing or two about it? You know, you go, Brother Mike's been there a lot. You know, that's, you know, he's been in Jerusalem a lot. He knows where the good places to eat are, where the good places to stay are. He knows the things to see and the things to not to see and all of that. Because he's been to Jerusalem a lot. 60 times is a lot. He stayed at least 2 nights in Jerusalem every time. He'd been there a lot. And he knew a lot of people. Y'all know how personable Jesus was? He liked everybody, didn't he? Who didn't he like to talk to? He talked to everybody, didn't he? Yeah, he loved everybody. He talked to everybody. The important people, the unimportant people, everybody. He talked to everybody. So this is why he knew what was going on and what was going to happen. We have a story for later in the week on Thursday. When he was getting ready for the Last Supper, he told his disciples, go into the city, you'll see a man carrying water. What? Well, men didn't carry water very often. happened back then. You know whose job it was? You ladies, sorry about it. That was women's work. And to see a man carrying water was unusual. So go in and see the man carrying water and then follow him to where he goes and set up a place for him. He met the man. He knew the man. He probably could have told you his name. So Jesus had been there a lot. Now, I told you the symbolism with the children. I hope y'all were listening. Y'all can listen to the children's time, all right, adults? It's okay to listen. I give you permission to listen. Don't comment, but you can listen. So, you know the symbolism is, I want to look at two particular verses. You heard them just now. After he's talking to the Pharisees, telling him to make his disciples be quiet, that's another little side story there. If I tell them to be quiet, what's going to happen? The rocks are going to shout. Have y'all ever heard rocks shout? What noise do they make when they make noise? Is it a noise you want to hear? Big rocks making noise? That's usually not a good thing, is it? In Jerusalem, they would hear the rocks make noise when they had an earthquake. Don't want to hear that either, do you? You know, all right, let's not tell the people to be quiet because we don't want to hear from the rocks. That's a good thing. Rocks stay quiet. So Jesus says, he's crying over Jerusalem, and he says, it is too bad that today your people don't know what will bring them peace. Not just back then either, is it? I mean, that's our world condition today, isn't it? That we don't know what will bring us peace. Do we want peace?
Yes.
We sing a song about it, and we've sang it here in church before. Where does peace begin? We sing, let it begin with
me.
And it doesn't begin with the outside of you, it begins with what?
Inside.
See, it's not. And I want to change the words just a little bit from what Jesus says. It's not that we don't know what will bring us peace. We don't know who will bring us peace. Because it's Him, isn't it? It's Him. It's Jesus. And see, we have less excuse than they did back then, because when He first said this, this was pre-resurrection. You and I are post-resurrection. We know the story. We just forget sometimes. We forget to let Him live in us. We forget to let Him direct us day by day, hour by hour. We want to take care of things ourselves. I want to make peace in my life. I was sitting outside the other day. I did some yard work this week and just enjoying my backyard for a little bit. And have y'all sat outside here in town? Yeah, I don't know what your neighborhood is like. It's either somebody's got the weed eater going, the leaf blower, or their truck is rumbling around, or a motorcycle's going by. I get to hear the park as well, but I really don't mind the park. People cheering for ball games, that's really a nice sound. I like to hear that. That's kind of fun part of where I live. But all the other, I think, oh my goodness, those people shouldn't be allowed to drive around making that much noise. See, I'm putting my peace outside of me. And let me say this. Those folks that are making the noise, they're not taking my peace away from me. I'm giving it to them. I'm just handing it to them. I'm saying that my peace resides outside of me somewhere, and when that outside is messed up, then I'm messed up. When is the outside going to be fixed? Ever? So I'm just wrong to expect for the outside to get fixed before anything's fixed inside. Right? What's got to get fixed first? Inside of me. If I let Him live inside of me and bring me peace, can anything take it away? No. No. Not even the leaf blowers. Those are loud. Oh my goodness. Sometimes I think my neighbor's out there for a long time. That's not my neighbor's people two streets over. Taking my peace away from me. I'm giving it away. Do you want to give away your peace?
No.
Do you want to have peace?
Yes.
Do you want our world to have peace?
Yes.
It starts here with us, and it starts in our lives. We've got to know Him, and we've got to let Him live in us. And He will give us peace. He is the way and the truth and the life. And we live only with Him. Let's pray. Lord God, help us. Help us to take You into our lives, and help us to let You live in us, not just on Sunday mornings, but every day, every hour of every day. We ask this in Your name. Amen. We have our time of reflection and giving now. A time to think of what God has given to us. I'm especially grateful this morning for our children and their willingness to sing God's praises with us. It was hard for me not to sing with y'all. I like that song a lot. That's a good song. I know you have things you're grateful for as well. And there's no way we can repay God. God doesn't really need our money. God wants us. Every one of us. And all of us. He wants all of our lives. All the little parts of our lives. All the little things we separate. He wants to bring together and have it all. And He wants to make it wonderful. So, we give back as a sign of our love and our gratefulness. And we're doing that today with extravaganza. We do it with our tithes. We do it with offerings. We do it with how we live day by day. So, I'd like our ushers to come forward now. Thank you, gentlemen. And we will give to God. Let us pray. Lord God, we give thanks to You for all that You have given to us. And we ask, O Lord, that You would receive this offering, that You would bless it and multiply it for Your kingdom here on earth. In the name of Christ Jesus, our Lord. Amen. Thank you. Concerns? What prayer concerns would you like to lift up? I know we need to lift up the Dolson family. Thomas Dolson passed away yesterday morning about 2 o'clock. And he was a longtime superintendent here of the Sealy Schools and a faithful member of this church. And so keep his family in your prayers, please. Are there others? Ron?
My grandson Daniel is going to have surgery on Wednesday.
Daniel?
Daniel.
Pray for Daniel. Others?
Trenton.
My hearing is not the best. Thank you. Charlie?
My grandmama?
Roby, keep Roby in our prayers. Others? Yes, ma'am?
Pray for the family of a friend of mine. Her name is Isella. She died on Wednesday.
I lost that last part.
She passed away last Wednesday.
A student at the high school.
Oh, okay.
Yes.
And so what's the family name?
Isella. Rivera is the last name.
Rivera?
Yes.
Pray for the Rivera family. Others?
Karen Stone. On Friday, and she should be getting her results any day now.
And she had another test?
Yeah.
Karen Stone.
Michelle Cackle.
These are folks we've been praying for a while. That's good. Thank you. Yes, sir?
Derek's tonsil surgery.
You do it after me on purpose. Garrett?
Garrett's tonsil.
Oh, Garrett's.
Garrett. He went back over there.
There you go. T-O-N-S-I-L. Better pray for the ice cream supply.
Bluebell's close.
Louise Cachera.
My sister Emily and her husband Josh, they are ministers at a church in New Mexico, and they're leaving their ministry to go to another town and start a new ministry. So big change for them.
Pray for Emily and Josh.
Yes. And my parents who follow them around everywhere.
Are they staying in New Mexico?
Or? Yeah, they're moving from a little town called Raton to Roswell. So my dad's excited because he'll have 2 donut stores. So
Roswell is bigger than Raton.
Yeah, he's like, yay, places to eat. And a Walmart. So
probably higher there too, though.
Yeah.
All right. Pray for Emily and Josh. Are there others? Let's go to our Lord in prayer and meditation. Lord God, we are so thankful that you come to us. Even as you ride on a donkey, we lift you up as Lord and King. You are humble. But we know that you are great. Even beyond our imaginations, you are good. You are the King. Help us to keep you on the throne of our lives, Lord. Every day, every hour. Help us to not give away our peace, but to spread your good news wherever we go. Help us to tell people about you. And help us to do it mainly with how we live. The words that we speak. And the way that we act. Help us to tell people about you. And when necessary, help us to use the right words. Lord, this morning we bring to you these our prayer concerns. You know each one, Lord. You know all of the individuals. And you love them. We are lifting them up to you to help us remember. To help us to be a blessing. And we're thankful for the opportunity. We ask all of these things and we pray these prayers in the name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And we join together in the prayer that he taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Our closing song this morning is, Lord, I lift your name on high. That's a good thing for us to do. Let's sing. You can wave your palm branches again if you want to.
Lord, I lift your name on
I'm not afraid to die.
being here this morning. I hope you go out and have a wonderful day today. Hope to see you down at the park at 1. Let's go forth in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and our Savior. Let Him be the Prince of Peace in our lives. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen.